Some people think your distance is just the words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables and a down along the way. But I've seen you part the water when no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset and in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me.
You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. But I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love?
But I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees.
You're everything I need. You're amazing, faithful, love. Love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are. You are greater, higher, over and all. In your presence, Jesus, I stand in awe of your. What holds your heart? What stirs your soul? What matters comes to mind? The cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not a wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing or dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your hands and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Years roll by, we wonder why we lost our way from home. Our father finds the child inside, We were led for growing old. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing or dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your hands and keep singing. Praise the Lord. With everything, praise the Lord. In the working, in the waiting, praise the Lord. In the blessing, in the breaking, come on and praise the Lord. In the dying, in the rising, come on and praise the Lord. Come on and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing or dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing or dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord.
I can't tell you why you're walking through this valley, and I can't tell you just how long you've got to stay, and I can't tell you why your heart feels so unsettled, or when this all will change. But I can tell you there is something you can lean on. It's a promise that won't bend and it won't break. And it will keep you when the future is uncertain. You're not out of grace. When the darkness overwhelms you and your fear just won't subside, when your questions outweigh answers on those long and lonely nights, friend, you've got to keep on moving. He is with you in the valley of despair, and he won't leave you there. He is with you when you think you just won't make it, and he is right there when it looks like hope is lost. You're gonna find out he's nothing less than faithful. So keep holding on, keep holding on. When the darkness overwhelms you and your fear just won't subside, when your questions outweigh answers on those long and lonely nights, friend, you've gotta keep on moving. He is with you in the valley of despair, and he won't leave you there. He won't leave you there. No, darkness overwhelms you and your fear just won't subside. When your questions outweigh answers on those long and lonely nights, friend, you've got to keep on moving. He is with you. Oh, when the darkness overwhelms you and your fear just won't subside, when your questions outweigh answers on those long and lonely nights, friend, you've got to keep on moving. He is with you in the valley of despair, and he won't.
Church on a Wednesday night, ain't it? Amen. Can you all hear me okay? Okay. Amen. Thankful tonight for those that good singing and those good testimonies. And it's just, it's good to be here tonight. It is good to be here. Felt like I ain't got to preach here in about 6 years. That's what it feels like. But it's good to be here tonight. And thankful for everything God's doing. He is faithful. And he's continued to stay faithful. And I don't look for him to slip up anytime soon. He's been faithful all this long. I look for him to continue to stay faithful. Man, it's just good. Thankful for everything God does for my family. And I'm thankful for what God allows me to do. I am, to be able to go from place to place and meet new people. And there's all kinds of people, different kinds of people. And I appreciate what he allows me to do. It's just it's wonderful. I tell you, I appreciate it, but I don't think my girls do. I don't think they appreciate it. I don't think they like going anywhere else but here. Sunday morning, I'll tell you this real quick. Sunday morning, we was getting ready, and I play this game with them. I sing to them all the time. I'm all the time making up songs and stuff and singing to them. And Tanley, she smiles and laughs at anything you do. And I was singing a song. I do it all the time. I say, if you love your daddy, clap your hands. Well, they think that's the funniest thing in the world. They laugh and they clap and they jump up and down. And Tinley, she just claps and dances and just thinks it's, I mean, she'll come running if I sing that song. And she'll make sure I see her clap. Well, we was singing that song, playing. And I said, okay, girls, it's time to get ready for church. And Macy turned real quick. And when she hears that word, she wants to know where we're going. She's got to that point where she asks. And this is what she says. She says, are we going to Daddy's church or Papaw's church? That's the two things she says. And that's how she can tell the difference. And I said, no, Mace, this morning we're going to Daddy's church. And boy, them eyebrows went down. And she looked at me and she said, if you hate Daddy's church, clap your hands. And I mean, she clapped them hands. She made sure I seen her clap those hands. She waved them way out there. She kept singing that and I just thought, Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Yeah. Then she got done singing that, and she said, if you love Papaw's church, clap your hands. And then she made sure I seen her clap on that one, too. So I told that story to say this. You keep me in your prayers and pray for me as I raise two daughters. But it is good. It is good to laugh. It's good to laugh. I know there's some people who don't think you should laugh in church, but I know I've noticed and realized I spent a lot of my time in church. And if I can't laugh in church, I may as well not laugh anywhere. So I think it's okay to laugh. And my goodness, in the day and hour we're living in, I wish some people would laugh. I wish some people would smile. Yeah. Amen to that. I wish some people would smile. Tonight, if you have your Bibles, you want to follow with me, I'm going to be in the book of Judges. Book of Judges. Chapter number 3. I'm going to read one verse to you tonight. One verse. I usually read more than that, but tonight this is just one verse. Judges chapter number 3. Judges number 3. You pray for my voice. We went out Sunday and that church liked preaching. My voice is shaky. Judges chapter number 3. Judges 3, going to start with verse number 31. Only verse I'm reading. It says this. And after him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, which slew the Philistines 600 men with an ox goat. And he also delivered Israel. I'm going to read it one more time. And after him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, which slew the Philistines, 600 men with an ox goad. And he also delivered Israel. Tonight, from the time that we was born and from the time that we die, whether we realize it or not or know it or not, we're telling a story, whether you know it or not. To the world, to people you work with, to everyone around our community, you're telling a story. It's up to you if the story's good or the story's bad, more or less. But from the time we're born, from the time we die, from those years, there's a story that's being written in our life. A lot of times, people look at how we act. People look at how we carry ourselves, especially when our world's been flipped upside down. And people want to see how we carry ourselves. And just be real with you, some sinners want to see just how big our God is sometimes, I believe. And they watch how we act. They watch how we carry ourselves. We're telling a story is what we're doing. And here tonight, I want to preach on a man by the name of Shamgar. Does anybody know anything about Shamgar? Not a whole lot of hands went up. I didn't know a whole lot about Shamgar. I began to look and begin to study this man. And here's the crazy thing about Shamgar. I read this verse to you tonight, this one verse. And here's the crazy thing about Shamgar is his story takes one verse to write. It takes one verse. I read this, I look at it, and I try to find more on Shamgar, but there just isn't any more to know on Shamgar than what I just read to you in this one verse. His verse, it takes one verse to tell his whole story. And really, tonight, his story seems so random, really, and it seems so unnecessary. It really does. I was trying to study the life of Shamgar the best I could, looking at his life, studying his life. And the more I did, I even heard one preacher say this. He said that if you take the time to preach on Shamgar, then you're wasting your congregation's time. There isn't just much to know about him. And I hope that's not the case tonight, because I prayed, felt like I did my part, and I hope I ain't wasting anybody's time here tonight by preaching on this man named Shamgar. But that's what he said. He said, there's not much to know about him. He said, you're best to read the verse. He said, if there was any verse in the Bible that was unnecessary and as random as this one, he said, it's Judges chapter number 3 and verse 31. Said, it doesn't tell us anything about Shamgar. I said, this is the first time you see Shamgar's name, and you only see it one other time. His name is only mentioned twice in the entire Bible, Shamgar. But if you look at it close enough and you study it close enough, I believe there's things that can impact us here tonight by studying what this man did with just this one verse. I believe that. Honestly, tonight, I don't know why the prophet Samuel took the time to write this verse, but I believe every verse is there for a reason. I believe every word in the Bible is there for a reason. I believe every comma, every period, everything is exactly what's supposed to be. I don't think the Bible needs to be rewritten, but I do think it needs to be reread sometimes. Somebody say amen on that. I look at this verse tonight and see that this man Shamgar takes one verse to write his whole story. And I think to myself, if I would have been the one writing the book of Judges, if you would have been the one writing the book of Judges, I'll just speak for myself in saying, I probably wouldn't have took the time to write verse number 31. Because what he did, it just seems so small, so random, and so unnecessary. But if you look into this long enough and study it hard enough, you see that in Shamgar's life, there was a transformation that took place in his life. Look at what the Bible says. The Bible says, and after him, Shamgar, the son of Anath, which slew the Philistines, 600 men with an ox goad. There was a transformation that took place in his life, Shamgar. He was a farmer. He was a cattle herdsman. And God called him from being a farmer and a cattle herdsman to a warrior and to a soldier. There was a transformation that took place in his life. Can you see it? Can you see how he was a farmer? He was a cattle herdsman, and God transformed him into a warrior. This shows me that Shamgar was one of those. He didn't care what it was. He didn't care what God wanted him to do. He was willing to fill in the gap and whatever the case may have been. He was willing to do that. There was a transformation. I look at David. Look at David's life. His own father looked at him and told him that he would be the most likely to succeed in his whole family. But we all know the story of David. No, that was the exact opposite of what happened. And the story of David. How many sermons down through the years have you heard about David and David this and David that? I mean, one of the best commanders in chief in the whole Bible, probably you could say. I'm thankful today for the transformation that took place in our lives when we got saved. But I believe that there was a transformation that takes place even after we get saved. See, we don't get saved just to come to church, sit in the pew, and expect Tom to bless our socks off every once in a while. But there's more work that needs to be done than just coming, sitting in a pew, than going home and watching TV on the couch. But we're living in a day and hour where there's people dying, lost, going to hell every single day. We are surrounded by people that's lost and going to hell. And I believe that we need a transformation in ourselves that says, God, I'm this right now. But listen, let's look at it this way. I believe we're sitting in this service tonight, and there may be some future deacons sitting right here in this very congregation. There might be some future preachers sitting right here in this congregation. There might be some future Sunday school teachers sitting in this congregation tonight. Future singers and future door greeters and future this and future that sitting right here tonight. And I feel like we're living in a day and time where we need people to transform into what they are, into what God wants them to be. Because see, he was very comfortable being a farmer. He was comfortable being a cattle herdsman, but God said, okay, that's good and great, but I need more from you than that. I need you to turn from a farmer for a little while into a warrior, and that's exactly what Shamgar did. And can I say tonight, we're living in a time where we need some people to transform them into what they are, into what God wants them to be. Because look, I go out all the time, and I'll say that 80% of the places I go ain't got no pastor. They ain't got no preachers. They ain't got no singers. Ain't got no door greeters. They ain't got nothing. They ain't got nothing. And I think a part of that is just the day and hour that we're living in. But I also think a part of that, too, is people ain't transformed into what they need to be for God. They're satisfied with sitting on a pew not doing anything, coming to church and expecting somebody to bless their socks off and send them home, and they're happy with that. But can I say there's more to life? They're just coming and sitting on that comfortable pew. There's a work that needs to be done. So God, make me today different than what you want me to be. I want to be big for God. I want people to look at my life and say, man, I want what that boy has. I'll just use this for an example. A couple months ago, I went down the road here to a church. And they opened back up about a month ago. And we wasn't having church on Sunday evening at the time. Tyson found out I was going, and that boy wants to be in church right now more than anybody else in here. I guarantee you that. And he said, Kev, I'll go with you. I said, okay. He goes with me, and I kind of thought, well, Tyson's been on fire. He's been fired up. I mean, he comes to church. He don't sit there quiet. You know what I mean? You all know. And I talked to Dad Monday. I said, how was the service this Sunday? I said, was Tyson real quiet? And he said, no. Gene went up there and got a hold of him. They went to heaven and back, and... But he went with me. He went with me. Well, I just went there this past Sunday, and a man come up to me, and this is what he said. He said, hey, who was that big boy you brought with you a while back? I said, that's my cousin. I said, it's Tyson. He just lives right down the road from me. He said, I can't quite put my finger on it. He said, but there's something I like about that boy. That's what he told me. He was in service with Tyson one time. But see, there was a transformation that took place in Tyson's life. He was saved, and he was coming to church. And I mean, he was doing right. But see, there was something bigger that God had for him if he was willing to transform himself and grab a hold of what it was. You understand what I'm trying to say? There's more to this thing than just coming and sitting here and taking in everything. There's a work that needs to be done. A work that needs to be done. So, God, if you want me to be a farmer, if you want me to be a warrior, I'll be whatever you want me to be. It doesn't make no difference to me. It doesn't make no difference to me. There was a transformation that took place in Shamgar's life. But not only was there a transformation that took place in Shamgar's life, but there was also a contribution that took place in his life. He defeated 600 soldiers. That's what the Bible said. I read it to you a couple times. He defeated 600 soldiers. And you know what tonight? That seems so small. Seems so small compared to what the other judges did. You look at what Othniel did, it takes a whole chapter to write his story. You look at what Deborah did. You look at what Ehud did. You look at what Barak did. It takes verse after verse after verse and some chapter after chapter to write their story. Because what they did, man, they played a big part. They did. And then you look at this one little simple, random, unnecessary verse about Shamgar. And his little 600 soldiers that he defeated just seems so small. Othniel defeated an entire nation. Ehud defeated 10,000 soldiers. Deborah and Barak defeated 900 chariots, I believe it was, if I remember studying right. And I look at that and think to myself, Man, 600 soldiers may seem like a lot to us tonight, but if you look at what everybody else did, it seems so small. Seems so small. But in my mind, I feel like Shamgar was the type of person that if he was here tonight, he would be the type of church member that would say, Tom, if you need me to lead the service tonight, if you need me to take out the garbage, if you need me to tie your shoe, if you need me to run the sweeper, I'll do whatever you need me to do. I just want to make an impact. I just want to make an impact. I want to make a difference. I want to help in any way that I can. He was a, I believe that Shamgar was a facilitator. He was somebody that didn't care what it was. He was willing to fill in the gap and make the impact. Now I feel like we're living in a day and we're living in a time where the only time that people want to make a contribution is when they're getting patted on the back and when they're, you got people in your corner and they got people cheering them on. And the very first time that Pastor Tom doesn't shake their hand on Sunday morning, they're ready to turn their back and go the other direction. I'm just telling you, that's the 2020 Christian, what I explained to you right there. I'll make a contribution. I'll do something, but I got to make sure if I do it, I'm going to get a pat on the back from somebody. Listen, that's not what God looks down and smiles on tonight. He wants somebody that says, I don't care what it is. If you need me to go out and wipe the dumpsters down, if you need me to power wash the blacktop, it makes no difference to me. I just want to be an impact in somebody else's life. I want to be a help to the church. I want to be a help to the church. I want to make an impact. Amen. Let's just be real. I'm just going to be honest with you. We're living in a time where anointed preaching and anointed singing and anointed Sunday school teaching is almost a thing of the past. It's where we're living. I'm telling you that God's honest truth. God's honest truth. Every preacher wants to sugarcoat everything to tickle everybody's ears and not hurt anybody's feelings because they don't want to lose anybody. Listen, if they're not preaching what's in the lids of this book, if they're not preaching what the Word of God says and they're sugarcoating everything, I don't want anything to do with that. I want to preach what's in the lids of this book. I want to preach it right. I want to study it right. I want to pray right. I want to live right. I want to do everything right. And we're living in a day where, yeah, people will make a contribution, but they want that pat on the back, and they do it to see how many followers they can get on Twitter or how many followers they can get on Instagram or how famous they can get or how big their name gets. And listen, it don't make no difference if California knows who I am or Walmsley down the road knows who I am. As long as I'm making my contribution towards God and I'm doing it with the right, pure, clean heart, I believe God's going to look down on that and He'll make your name great. I believe it was Abraham. I believe it was Abraham that more or less God looked down and said, Abraham, if you do this, 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 and this, I'll make your name great. That's what He said. And what did God do? He made Abraham's name great. And if you want God to make your name great, give a little bit. Give a little bit. Make an impact. Make a difference. Make a difference in somebody else's life. Whether you get a pat on the back or whether you don't. Because when you die and that choice comes where you go, it don't going to make no difference if you got a pat on the back or not. Ain't going to make no difference. Ain't going to make no difference. Let your life be about making a contribution and not about the name for yourself. Because that's the day we're living in right there. People wanting the big name, wanting to be the big shot, wanting to be the big guy on the block. Listen, it don't work. Don't make no difference. If you're the big one, the small one, Shamgar's story was just as impactful as the other ones if you study it out. Just as impactful. We see Shamgar's transformation. We see his contribution. But then we also see Shamgar's determination. His determination. Say, Caleb, that was one verse you read. I know that. I understand. How in the world do you see, how do you see a determination in Shamgar's life? Well, don't think for one second that Shamgar got that ox goad, and he stood in front of 600 soldiers and said, bring it on, boys. 600 versus 1. I got you. I got you. That's not how it happened. It's not how it happened at all. You study it out, and it says in chapter 5, verse 6, that in the days of Shamgar, the enemy would come through the highways and through the byways and around about and tried to sneak their way through and attack. And it was Shamgar's job to stand and watch. To stand and watch. And when one would try to sneak by, it was his job to take that ox goad and slay that Philistine. So tonight I want to preach on this. We need some Shamgars. We need some Shamgars. Because there's going to be an enemy out there who's going to come through the highways and the byways And he's going to try to get in on the inside of here. And he's going to try to cause a division like we ain't ever seen before. So what we need right now is some sham guards to stand and watch. And when he sees that enemy come to attack, take that goat rod and slay whatever enemy's trying to get on the inside of this place. You know what scares me to death? You know what keeps me awake at night? That in 20 years, we walk in this church and there ain't no compassion, there ain't no power, there ain't no tears, there ain't no shouting, there ain't no people standing to their feet. There ain't nobody to lead a song. There ain't nobody to lead a service. There ain't nobody to preach God's word. It scares me to death. Listen, I've got two girls that's grown up. And I worry. It keeps me awake at night. It keeps me awake at night to think, what in the world are they going to have in 10 years? What are they going to have in 15 years? What are they going to have in 20 years? So you know what we need right here tonight at Beach Fork Church? We need some people to stand up and say, I want to be a sham guard. I don't care if it's a small story. I don't care if it's a big story. I want to make an impact in people's life. I don't care if God wants to transform me into what I am, to what he wants me to be. But that's what we need. We need some determined people to stand up and say, I'm not going to bend to these things of this world. I'm not going to bend to the ways of the change that's taking place. Listen, churches are changing every day, and they're changing quick. They're taking out altars, they're taking out pulpits, they're taking out everything to try to draw people in. You want to know what draws people in? Is letting the Holy Spirit be welcomed into the services. That's what draws people in this day and hour. And what we need is determined people to stand and say, I'm not going to bend to the ways of this world, but I'm going to be determined. I'm going with God. I'm going. What is wrong with a good old-fashioned way? There ain't a thing wrong with it. But people's trying to fix the old-fashioned way for new things. And let me tell you something, it just does not work. It doesn't work. I mean, there's so many. I got a King James Bible tonight, and when I started preaching, Mark and Debbie bought me a Thompson Chain King James Bible study. It's a study Bible. And I mean, I have the pages wore out on that baby. I mean, I love that Bible. I don't know if it's because Mark and Debbie bought it for me. I don't know if she prayed. I don't know what it is, but I love that Bible. I mean, I got highlights on there, everything. And there's nothing wrong with the good old King James Bible believing way. I mean, we're living in a time where there's so many versions of what the Bible is. They have versioned their way out of it being the Word of God. I mean, that's the day now we're living in. Taking out altars, taking out pulpits, bringing in fog machines, putting up purple lights. I mean, doing all kinds of crazy things just to try to get a few people to come to their service. But if they would get down on their knees and welcome the Holy Spirit to come in, get good and determined they're not going to go through the ways of this world, I believe God would look down and bless. Bless their services. I believe that. We need some good old determined people. Churches are falling away to nothing. And it's because the saints of old are starting to die off. I'm just telling you the truth. And there's a few places I'm going right now that I look at. And if God doesn't intervene in a mighty way, they're two or three deaths away from closing the door and not having church there no more ever again. Because there's about four or five old people there who's trying their best to keep those doors open for people in the community who doesn't care. Who doesn't care. I know tonight this ain't real popular and this isn't real. This is what God laid on my heart. Laid on my heart for I'm preaching this message tonight to Beach Fork Church. And letting Beach Fork know that we need some sham guards. We need some sham guards. We need some to rise up. And they need to transform into what they are. Into what God needs them to be. For this church. For this church. We need some to make contributions. To help. Fill in the gap. We've had some saints here go on to heaven ourselves. Been a few of them. And I think about them all the time. I'd probably say every day. I think about them. Every day. I see James Ray's face every time before I get up here. Every time I preach, I see James Ray's face. It's instilled in my mind. That head thrown back and him spitting right under my eye. And saying, you preach and preach with everything you got. And I remember that every single time. Whether I'm preaching to 3 people or 500 people, I see James Ray's face in my mind every time. Tell me to preach with everything I got. I don't want to let him down. I think of Ron. I think of Big John. I think of all of them all the time. And it ain't going to be too much longer to where all the saints here are going to be gone. going to be gone. We need a young generation to step up. That's what we need. We need some Shamgars. Need some Shamgars to stand. And when the enemy tries to come through the highways and the byways, stand and fight. Because this is our land. This is our property right here. This is ours. This is what God give us. And it's our job to protect it. Our job to protect it. We need some Shamgars to stand and watch. Stand and watch. And even though his story seems small, and even though it seems unnecessary, I look at this story and I think to myself, him doing what he did, I wonder how many people's lives were saved because him doing what he did. We'll never know. We'll never know how many lives were saved by him being faithful, even though it was small. Even though it was small. I look at Jesus' life when he was here on this earth for 33 years, and he was determined. He knew when he was here what had to be done and was determined that he was going to get that done. Even though people tried to stop it, disciples tried to stop it, he knew that there was a job that had to be done to die for you and for me. And he had a determination in his heart that it was going to get done. He even laid. We all know he laid and cried out the words, Father, if it will, let this pass from me. He said, but not thy will, but yours be done. Yours be done. He knew deep down in his heart. And he was determined that there was a goal. There was a goal and a plan to save us. And he stuck to it. He was determined to do it. Determined to do it. And tonight we have a goal and we have a plan to not bend and to not change to what this garbage into this world, this garbage is thrown in our face. I'm telling you the truth tonight. I'm telling you the God's honest truth. I know. I've heard stories. I've talked to people. I know. I go all the time. I see what it's like. I see what churches was in 2016 and they're not the same in 2020. I promise they're not. And it's because there's been a few saints die. And eventually they're all going to be gone and there's going to be nothing. Going to be nothing. We need some Shamgars. We need some Shamgars to stand up and to fill in the gap. Fill in the gap. We've always been blessed here. We've always been blessed here to have young people. Haven't we? We always have. I mean, since I've been around, we've always had young people. I mean, tonight we had young people sing to us. I mean, every service we got young people that sing to us. I've noticed our young people use the altar. They pray. I've watched them, some of them raise their hand. I've watched some of them grow. And you know what it does? It makes my heart overflow with joy. Knowing that, man, there's churches that would do anything to have young people sing in a service. Would do anything to have young people raise their hand in a service, pray in a service, do those things. I believe we have some Shamgars raising up. Raising up. There's an enemy out there that's Satan himself. And he's going to try his best, do his very best. Notice these people, they tried to sneak through. These Philistines tried to sneak through. And that's exactly what the devil does. He just doesn't openly come out. He likes to sneak his way in somehow, some way small. And he likes to make it bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger to where we got a mess on our hands. We got a mess on our hands. So tonight I want to preach to you on this. We need some Shamgars. That's all I got. That's all I got. People to rise up. I know this is different, and I heard that preacher say that if you preach a sermon on Shamgar, you're wasting the congregation's time, and I hope I didn't waste your time tonight. Hope I didn't waste your time. I pray and ask God, God, show me what you want, and this is what God showed me. This is what God showed me. So I'm going to ask you if you would, and I'd stand to your two feet.